Can you be immune to the COVID-19 virus without even having it? Let's talk about the very real possibility. I'm Dr. Keith Moran. In my video, Odds of Dying from COVID-19 versus Other Coronaviruses, I talk about the other coronaviruses that infect humans. Four of these coronaviruses cause the common cold. Many people have been exposed to these viruses in the past. Will this mean that there will be some degree of immunity because people have had exposure? Let's find out. First, it's helpful to give you a very brief review on how immunity occurs in humans. When a virus comes into the body, it's usually eaten by a cell called a macrophage, and then the macrophage presents the virus to a T cell. The T cell is a specific kind of white blood cell. The T cell then tells another type of white cell, the B cell, to turn into plasma cells, which then make antibodies. The antibodies are special proteins which will ultimately bind to the virus so that the body can recognize and then destroy the virus. We can obviously measure specific antibodies to specific viruses to look at this kind of immunity. This is one type of immunity called antibody or humoral immunity. The other kind of immunity is called cell-mediated immunity because it involves cells. It specifically involves the T cells. T cells can release proteins that lead to other T cells and macrophages getting activated, telling them to destroy the virus and any infected cells. As an aside, this type of immunity is important in destroying bacteria, other microorganisms, as well as cancer cells. The T cells remember the viruses that are presented to them. This kind of memory has been shown to last for years, which is based on a number of studies. Depending upon the virus in question, the antibody response may only last for months, and this may be the case with the novel coronavirus, which is called SARS-CoV-2. This is something that's being actively studied. It's relevant because vaccine candidates against SARS-CoV-2 are designed to produce an antibody response, and this may wane with time. With certain vaccinations that we give in medicine, such as tetanus, antibody levels drop with time, and thus booster vaccinations are required to keep up the antibody levels. However, some antibody responses can last, such as measles, for a lifetime. A recent study reported in the journal Cell took a look at measuring immunity to SARS-CoV-2 in order to further understand COVID-19 and vaccine development. They looked at cell-mediated immunity in particular. They looked at T cell responses in two groups of people. One group were people who had recovered from COVID-19. The other group was from people who donated blood from 2015 to 2018. The latter group were obviously unexposed individuals to SARS-CoV-2 as the blood was drawn before the pandemic. In the group of patients with COVID-19, they showed 100% T cell recognition of SARS-CoV-2 as expected. But the interesting thing was that 40 to 60% of the other group, in other words, patients who had never had exposure to SARS-CoV-2, actually had measurable T cell recognition of the virus. If you take a look at SARS-CoV-2 and other coronaviruses' structure, many of the proteins on the viral surface of the particles are actually identical. This study has been replicated in patients from Germany, Singapore, and the Netherlands, and similar numbers of people, 30 to 50%, were shown to have measurable T cell recognition of SARS-CoV-2. This may very well explain the fact that 30 to 50% of people, when they acquire SARS-CoV-2, are actually completely asymptomatic because they have had T cell immunity to quickly fight off the virus. It's not known at this point how protective this will be against COVID-19 in individuals who already have T cell recognition, but it makes sense that it could be significant, as I just mentioned. We do not have the ability to do widespread testing in the population of who has T cell recognition or not. If this is protective, then obviously herd immunity could easily occur at much lower levels. Generally, it's felt that this virus, depending on who you read, that once 50 to 80% of the population has been infected based on antibody tests, new cases are unlikely to occur, meaning herd immunity. But think for a minute, what if 40% of people already have T-cell immunity and 20% of people have antibody immunity? Perhaps this is enough to lead to herd immunity. Ultimately, more research is needed, but this is certainly a very positive finding. Lastly, I always try to put something very interesting towards the end of the video for those still with me. This is a mask study I want to tell you about done in hamsters. Obviously, as I've mentioned before in my videos, it's not ethical to do mask studies in humans looking at transmission of the COVID-19 virus, as transmission could obviously lead to death and infecting other people. This particular study is peer-reviewed and reported in the journal Clinical Infectious Diseases. Masks on hamsters, you say? How did they do that? No, they did not do this. That picture's from the New York Post. They actually took hamsters who had SARS-CoV-2 infection, which they called challenged index hamsters, and placed them in cages beside hamsters who did not have the infection, which we called exposed naive hamsters. They then studied non-contact transmission, meaning that hamsters in each cage had no contact with the hamsters in the other cage. Here is an image of their experiment to give you an idea of what it actually looked like. They had partitions between the two cages with a fan inducing airflow through a porous polyvinyl chloride partition between the two cages. They studied non-contact transmission from one cage to another without a surgical mask, as well as non-contact transmission when a surgical mask was placed between the two cages. The transmission rate of the virus was 67% in 96 hours when there was no mask between the cages. When the surgical mask was used between the two cages, the transmission rate was only 16%, which was highly statistically significant. Obviously, one limitation to the study was the fact that once one of the hamsters in the cage without SARS-CoV-2 contracted the virus, that hamster would have direct contact with the other hamsters, which could increase the number of hamsters acquiring the virus in the rest of the cage. Also, when they looked at clinical scores, as well as histopathological changes in the respiratory tissue and viral antigen expression, these scores were much lower in the infective naive hamsters than the previously infected challenged hamsters. Presumably, this is because the inoculum, which means the number of viral particles, is much less because of the surgical mask. This obviously makes sense. I have been saying this for some time, that while viral swab testing for SARS-CoV-2 gives you either a positive or negative value, there really are different kinds of positive numbers, from small numbers of viral particles to large number of viral particles, which could measure in the millions or billions. We know that it appears that you need to have at least 100 viral particles to establish an infection with SARS-CoV-2. It would make sense that the more viral particles that you acquire, the more severe the illness will be. This is what the hamster study is demonstrating. In the discussion of the study, the authors commented, and I quote, "Protective effect of masking may not just determine the success or failure of SARS-CoV-2 transmission, but it may also determine the severity of COVID-19 in the case of successful transmission. For example, in Hong Kong, where the population has a mask use compliance rate of 96.6% during local COVID-19 epidemic, both the incidence rate, which was 1,048 cases per 7.5 million population, and crude fatality rate of 4 out of 1,048, meaning 0.4% of COVID-19, were among the lowest in the world at the time the study was written," end quote. There's no question that surgical masks are not perfect, and even N95 masks will not prevent 100% transmission of this virus, but there's no question both will significantly reduce the risk of transmission, and in this study, the amount of transmission in high-risk scenarios. Remember that with any infection or disease, being healthy is the key to fighting it off successfully. A good diet, regular physical exercise, stress reduction, good sleeping habits, and avoiding those bad habits such as smoking or too much alcohol go a long way to keep your immune system and body in great shape. Thank you for joining me today on Medicine with Dr. Moran. I'm Dr. Keith Moran. Get healthy and stay healthy.